You're listening to BostonFreeRadio.com.
Hello and welcome to the show Words on Film on Boston Free Radio. I'm your host and movie critic Dan Burke. Words on Film is the spoken word show dedicated to moving pictures. You're either listening to me on BostonFreeRadio.com, watching and listening to me on SCATV, that is Somerville Community Access TV, or watching and listening to me on Facebook Live. I've got two channels going on, my own personal channel and Boston Free Radio's channel. Either way you could join me, I'm glad you could join me. So, got a lot to talk about this show. I've got five new movies to review, including Logan. But first, let's check out what's topping the box office. Beginning with the number one movie, which happens to be the highest grossing debut movie of the week, and that is Logan, which shouldn't come as a huge surprise. The only, I think, deterrent, I think, in predicting that Logan would be number one is because Logan is rated R. And I didn't think R-rated movies have less of a chance of hitting number one at the box office. But considering that, A, Logan is part of a major franchise, that is X-Men, and B, Deadpool last year had no problem reaching number one at the box office despite being rated R, I'm not too surprised. So anyway, Logan debuted with $88.4 million in domestic grosses and against a budget of $97 million. So it's not a hit yet in the U.S. yet, but by next week, it better be. However, around the world, including in the United States, Logan has so far made $247.4 million. So Logan is not a hit yet here in the United States, but around the world, it's already a certified hit. Number two at the box office this week was the number one movie last week, and that is Get Out, the one directed by Jordan Peele and starring Allison Williams, Bradley Whitford, and other notable actors. Get Out this weekend received $28.2 million in domestic grosses. Against a budget of just $4.5 million, Get Out has so far grossed $78.1 million, which means it's made over, I'm doing the math right now, 17 times its budget. So even though I don't have the international numbers for you for this movie, it's already a certified hit just in the U.S. and probably around the world as well. The Shack is the number two highest grossing debut movie, but it's number three at the box office. The Shack earned $16.2 million in the United States against a budget of $20 million. And I don't have the international numbers for you for this movie either. However, I can tell you that The Shack is not a hit yet here in the States, but is very, very close to being a tentative hit and should reach that level by next week. The Lego Batman movie is number four at the box office this weekend, sliding from number two last week. This weekend, the Lego Batman movie made $11.7 million. Against a budget of $80 million, the Lego Batman movie has so far made $148.7 million in the United States and $258 million worldwide. So the Lego Batman movie is a tentative hit here in the United States, but around the world, it is already a certified hit. Took a while for the movie to get there, but eventually it did. John Wick Chapter 2 is number 5 at the box office this weekend, having grossed $4.8 million. Against a budget of $40 million, John Wick Chapter 2 has so far grossed $82.9 million here in the United States and $144.4 million internationally, which makes John Wick Chapter 2, took this movie a while, but it finally made it, a certified hit here in the States and around the world. Before I Fall is the number three highest grossing debut movie of the week, but it falls at number seven in the top 10 at the box office, having grossed $4.7 million. And that's against a budget of $5 million. And I don't have the international numbers for Before I Fall right now, but here in the United States, it's not a hit yet, but it is very, very close and should definitely be at least a tentative hit by next week. Hidden Figures is a movie I'm just going to tell you it's a certified hit here in the States and around the world. This weekend it grossed $3.8 million. Against a budget of $25 million, Hidden Figures has so far grossed $158.8 million just in the United States, which is over six times its budget. Around the world, it has so far grossed $195 million. So even though Oscar season is over and Hidden Figures has won its awards and gotten the accolades it very, very richly deserves, it is on a decline in terms of box office gross, but it's still coming out a certified hit both here in the States and around the world, which is quite an accomplishment. The Great Wall is number 8 at the box office this weekend, sliding quite a bit from number 4 last week. It is not looking good for The Great Wall, at least here in the United States. This weekend it grossed $3.6 million against a budget of just $150 million. The Great Wall has, in the United States, grossed $41.4 million. That's it, against $150 million. So, The Great Wall is not going to be a hit in the United States. However, ironically, around the world, including in the United States, The Great Wall has grossed $320.2 million. So, it's one of those rare instances where the movie's a flop in the United States, but around the world, it's a certified hit, grossing more than twice as much as it cost to make, which actually is, which is undoubtedly a good thing, because if The Great Wall failed here, well, you would hope that the international numbers would save the movie, which fortunately it did. 50 Shades Darker is number 9 at the box office this weekend, sliding from number 5. This weekend, it grossed $3.6 million, just about as much as The Great Wall did this weekend. Against a budget of $55 million, 50 Shades Darker has grossed $110 million even, and a whopping $356.3 million worldwide, which makes it just made it to being a certified hit here in the United States, and it's also a certified hit around the world. Which, I'll just tell you right now, I shouldn't inject my opinion about this, but 50 Shades Darker did not deserve this. But moving on. La La Land, number 10 at the box office this past weekend, having grossed $3 million even. Against a budget of $30 million, it has so far grossed $145.7 million here in the United States and $396.4 million around the world, making it a certified hit here in the States and around the world.
Hey, what's up?
Welcome back to Words on Film on Boston Free Radio. I'm your host and movie critic, Dan Burke. Words on Film is the spoken word show dedicated to moving pictures, to which you are listening on bostonfreeradio.com or watching me on Somerville Community Access TV or on Facebook Live. Either way you could join me, welcome to the show. The first movie I'm going to review for you for this show is Logan. This is the latest Wolverine movie. It is the 9th X-Men movie, if you don't count Deadpool, and the 3rd to focus exclusively on Wolverine. So I'll tell you this much. I obviously have seen Logan this past weekend. If I didn't see it, I wouldn't review it. But I have not seen the other two Wolverine movies. I've seen the 3 X-Men films, the original Bryan Singer trilogy, except he didn't direct the 3rd one, so, well, you know what I mean. The first 3 movies, I saw them. I also saw the prequels, but I have not seen X-Men Origins Wolverine or the movie that's simply called Wolverine. But from what I've heard, I've heard some mixed to negative results of those movies. Which, even though they've made a lot of money, the critical backlash they've faced, both from established critics like myself and audiences, makes me almost wonder why they even bothered to make a 3rd movie. But I can tell you, from watching the 3rd movie, that the efforts to make a 3rd Wolverine movie were very well worth it. So, this movie, I'm not sure, because I haven't seen X-Men Origins or the Wolverine movie of 2013, I can't tell you what exactly narrative connection that Logan has with the other two Wolverine movies, but this movie, Logan, takes place in the near future, the year 2030 to be exact, which is only 13 years away if you can believe it. But in this near future, a weary Logan, also known as Wolverine, cares for an ailing Professor X in a hideout on the Mexican border. Why they're hiding out, I don't exactly know. I know that none of the prequels or even the original three X-Men movies, especially the third X-Men movie, provided any connection to this story, but you get some hints here and there. For instance, it's established that Professor X's mind is considered a weapon of mass destruction, so he's in hiding from the government. That much is established. How they got to that point, that's not really explained very well. But Logan's attempts to hide from the world and his legacy are upended when a young mutant arrives being pursued by dark forces. And this young mutant is a young girl named Laura, who's played in her big screen debut by a young girl named Daphne Keene. I don't know very much about Daphne Keene. I don't know what nationality she is. She might be Latina. She might be British based on her first name. I really don't know. And part of the reason I don't know is because you don't hear her talk throughout a majority of the movie. However, she has a really good deal of screen presence in this film, even though she doesn't say very much. And as it turns out, she is a mutant that's been created in a lab, and she, as well as other mutants, have escaped from this government-run lab and are hiding, or most of them are hiding out in North Dakota on the border between the U.S. and Canada. But I'm not exactly sure how Laura got separated from the other mutants, but either way, that's the way the plot goes. And Logan, despite not being good with kids, reluctantly agrees to transport Laura from the Mexican border to the Canadian border. So there's a really good setup here, and the chemistry between Daphne Keene and Hugh Jackman is really good. We all know that Hugh Jackman is one of the nicest guys in Hollywood, but he's made his living, of course, playing the rough around the edges Wolverine character. And this is actually the last time that Hugh Jackman says he's going to play Wolverine. But what a way to come out of playing that character. And keep in mind that Hugh Jackman has played the character of Logan, also known as Wolverine, for 9 movies. Every movie where there's been X-Men, Hugh Jackman has either played a pivotal role in or made a cameo in the movie as Wolverine, which means he's played Wolverine more times than Pierce Brosnan and Daniel Craig have played James Bond combined. That's quite a legacy, not to mention must have been a lot of energy to play that kind of character. But Hugh Jackman, even though he's older in this movie, shows, well, at least no signs of slowing down. But the reason I know that he's going to play Wolverine this very last time is because he said so in interviews. And I'm not spoiling anything that goes on in this movie, but there are a lot of surprises. And this movie earns its R rating. And what I mean by that is there's more swearing in this movie than there's been in other films. And also, Logan does some things with his Wolverine claws that are far more graphic than he's done in the other PG-13 rated Wolverine movies, but by no means is that unwelcome. A lot of people have been comparing Logan favorably to The Dark Knight. I get a little hesitant when I compare it to The Dark Knight, but very much like The Dark Knight, Logan takes its subject incredibly seriously and is not afraid to shy away from the dark side of such comic book characters. And I think it's actually very refreshing for this movie to have been rated R. And I think this is probably the movie that makes up for what the other two Wolverine movies lack, or what I think they could have lacked. But this movie could have been rated PG-13. James Mangold, the director of this movie, actually also directed the original, or rather the last Wolverine movie from 2013. He could have made it PG-13, especially because there's a kid in it. It could have been PG-13, but I, for one, am glad it wasn't. I thought it told an amazing story. I love the fact that it didn't shy away from being dark, and it's a movie I give my rating of a knockout to. It is so much fun to watch. It's great to see Hugh Jackman go out with a bang. It certainly looks like he's at least having a little bit of fun with this role, even if he looks tired, but that's what his character is supposed to be. So Logan is well worth watching. First great comic book movie of the year. Welcome back to Words on Film, the spoken word show dedicated to moving pictures. I'm your host and movie critic, Dan Burke, and the next movie I'm going to review for you is Get Out. Get Out is a movie that surprised everyone by hitting number one at the box office, and the movie is actually directed and written by Jordan Peele, who is one half of the comedy duo Key and Peele. So a lot of people would have expected that if Jordan Peele were to make his directorial debut, he would have directed a comedy. Well, as it turns out, Get Out does have its funny moments, but it's overall a horror suspense mystery about a young African-American man who visits his Caucasian girlfriend's mysterious family estate. So, at first, this movie makes you kind of think it's going to be something similar to Guess Who's Coming to Dinner. But eventually it evolves into, shall we say, almost an African-American version of The Stepford Wives, in the sense that you watch this film and you sort of realize that even though this Caucasian family may seem normal, these white people be crazy, to put it all lightly. But the young African-American man in this movie is named Chris Washington. That's his character's name. And he's played by a young British actor named Daniel Kaluuya. And Daniel Kaluuya's name and face may not entirely be familiar, but he's actually had some extensive acting experience up to this point. He was in Sicario, which was one of the most underrated films of 2015. He also played a rogue superhero in Kick-Ass 2, and also had a small role in the Rowan Atkinson vehicle Johnny English Reborn. But this is Daniel Kaluuya's first leading role, and it's certainly one that's very iconic. And his girlfriend in the movie is named Rose, and she's played by Allison Williams, who you might remember from the TV show Girls, which I think is still on the air, but it's in its final season. But Allison Williams is also making her, it's not her big screen debut, but it's probably her breakout role. So anyway, Chris and Rose are dating, and they live in a city that's unspecified. But eventually, Rose brings Chris back home to meet her parents, not mentioning to her parents that her boyfriend is black, because obviously that's a dead ringer. But despite this, Rose brings him home to meet the folks, and the folks actually don't seem entirely surprised that her boyfriend's black, which is kind of interesting at first, and I won't give away what significance that has later, but eventually you see a montage, or maybe it's a little longer than a montage. You see parts of this family being welcoming, but also being unintentionally patronizing towards Chris. And there are some things that the parents say, and also some close relatives of Rose's the character of Rose say to this young African-American man that make you cringe a little bit. And I think it probably could be seen as a parody of how white people react around black people these days, especially if they're the only black people in a certain area. But it's also probably a textbook example of what white people should not say to black people, even when they have the best intentions. It's interesting to see that. Sometimes they're really funny. Sometimes they're really cringeworthy. But Chris begins to notice something's wrong when he encounters the groundskeeper of this household, whose name is Walter, who's played by Marcus Henderson, who's also an African-American, and also their maid and chef, Georgina, who's played by an African-American woman named Betty Gabrielle. Now, I'm not sure if they're African-American or... Yeah, I'm pretty sure they are American, but IMDb is not telling me where they're actually from. But either way, there's something off about both of these two in general. And the patriarch of the family, whose name is Dean, and he's played by Bradley Whitford, tells Chris that it's... He kind of brushes it off that it's a cliche that he has two black people working for him. I'm thinking, well, cliche is not the right word. Is it unorthodox? Not entirely, but it might be a cliche maybe in the 1850s, but not in this millennium. It's another thing. Interestingly chosen words, but the movie really takes off when Chris is hypnotized by Rose's mother, Missy, who's played by Catherine Keener, in what he thinks is an attempt for him to stop smoking. But it turns out that he's put in a trance, and when he is put in this trance, it creates actually one of the most iconic images in this movie. And it's actually almost frightening to see the character of Chris get put in this trance. And you see his eyes widen, his jaws dropped, and tears running down his face. And Daniel Kaluuya did a really good job just being put into this trance that almost, it was frightening to look at. And he exudes how frightening it probably is to be put into this hypnosis. So there is a lot to remember about Get Out. There are a few plot holes here and there, some plot developments that didn't quite work, and there are some cringeworthy moments, but I think the cringeworthy moments were purposefully that way. But when the plot really gets going and the character of Chris realizes why he has to get out, as the title of this movie suggests, it really turns out to be one of the most top-notch horror suspense movies that I've seen in a really long time. It's very rare that horror movies actually star black characters as the leading roles, and when they do, it's usually the black people who get killed off first. I'm not going to say whether or not this happens, but this movie is refreshingly different from other such horror films, and it gets my rating of a knockout. It's a movie that's incredibly fun to watch. The funny moments are unexpected, and they certainly make you laugh. And also, welcome back to Words on Film on Boston Free Radio. I'm your host and movie critic, Dan Burke. Words on Film is the spoken word show dedicated to moving pictures. The next movie I'm going to review for you is The Great Wall. This is the latest starring Matt Damon, and it is one of the first collaborations between an American movie studio and a Chinese movie studio. So the majority of the people who are in this movie are Chinese, and the director of this movie is Yimou Zhang, who is Chinese, not Chinese-American, mind you. So this movie's fallen under a little bit of, actually quite a bit of controversy, particularly with Matt Damon being cast in the lead of this film. The movie's come under fire by a lot of Asian American activist groups, and even some actors like Constance Wu, who accuse this movie, in addition to other movies, of whitewashing. The point they have is valid, and on the one hand, I don't really blame the movie for casting an actor who is well known to a lot of American audiences, not to mention international audiences. On the other hand, this movie kind of takes a cop out with the introduction of this character. You don't know where he's from. Matt Damon has an American accent in this movie, and it's very unclear from where he hails. And the movie kind of cops out as to his background, and also does not explain very well why he's in China. But the movie is about European mercenaries who search for black powder and become embroiled in the defense of the Great Wall of China against a horde of monstrous creatures. So there are actually monstrous creatures that attack the Great Wall, making this movie a little bit more like Starship Troopers than, say, Bridger and the River Kwai, for instance, which, yeah, it didn't take place in China. It took place in Japan, but same kind of idea. But the movie at the very beginning has a written prologue that says that the Great Wall of China took 1,700 years to build. It's 5,500 miles long. I'm not sure how much that is in kilometers, but you could probably do the math. And then they say there are many legends about the Great Wall of China, and they say this is one of those legends. It's not a legend. No. The reason I say it's not a legend is because a screenwriter came up with it, the story and the screenplay, does not make it a legend. This is something that was made up 5 years ago, thereby not making it a legend. And one of the people who actually wrote the story, not the screenplay, but the story, was Max Brooks, who wrote the screenplay and the book World War Z. And actually, there are some moments in this movie that reminded me very much of World War Z, especially the parts of World War Z where there were these zombies who were scaling this giant wall, and they stack themselves on top of one another and then infiltrate the wall by essentially climbing over each other to get over them. And the creatures in this movie do the exact same thing the exact same way. So it almost made me feel like if Max Brooks wasn't involved in this movie, it might have been a little bit better. But also, what really didn't sit well with me was the fact that the army, which is comprised entirely of Chinese actors, which is good, had this elaborate army where everybody seemed to know what they were doing, but the movie seemed to imply that this army would have been completely lost without Matt Damon and his fellow European mercenary, a Spaniard by the name of Tovar, who's played by Pedro Pascal. So, Tovar and William, Matt Damon's character, are just two people. Granted, they do have notable archery skills, but having two people in the movie who don't come from China, who are just good with a bow and arrow, doesn't exactly help an entire army. In fact, the strength of this movie is the fact that the army was so elaborate, and all the actors in the movie did well with what they were given. But what really irked me was Matt Damon didn't need to be there. And I like Matt Damon. I like Matt Damon a lot. I've liked him ever since, well, probably School Ties. And, I saw him earlier in the movie Mystic Pizza as well, but School Ties was his most notable first role. In other words, the one where people noticed him before Good Will Hunting, of course. But I just felt like he was shoehorned into this movie just so, allegedly, Western audiences would have an excuse to see this movie. And that's really too bad, because I thought years ago when Ang Lee directed Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon, he directed an excellent kung fu movie with a compelling plot, which didn't need any Western actors in it. It had actors that were familiar to Western audiences, like Michelle Yeoh and Chow Yun-fat, but they were Chinese or Chinese-American actors. So the movie worked. People went to see it. It did really well in the United States. And so I could totally understand Constance Wu's and other activists decrying the whitewashing in this situation, because it is very prevalent here. But my other problem with the Great Wall was that, do you really need these superhuman creatures to put them into a movie about the Great Wall of China and make it? Is that the only way to make a movie like this compelling? If you made a movie about the building of the Great Wall, how or why it took 1,700 years to build, that's a fascinating fact. I don't know why this movie didn't just go with that, or go with the Chinese building the Great Wall in order to keep the Mongolians out. That's a compelling plot as well. Instead, you have this contrived, almost science fiction movie. The reason I say almost science fiction is because it takes place at an unspecified medieval time, but there are also these alien creatures. And I felt like those alien creatures were not particularly necessary to make this movie compelling. So, The Great Wall is not a bad movie. It has a lot of great special effects, but the story didn't need all those bells and whistles, which is why I give it my rating of a strikeout. Again, it would be a flunk out if it had a worse plot, but the plot was...
So you see, son, good manners are important. Should I go through...
Two words on film on Boston Free Radio. I'm your host and movie critic, Dan Burke. Words on Film is the spoken word show dedicated to moving pictures. Thanks for joining me. The next movie I'm going to review is Rock Dog. Rock Dog is an animated movie that features many anthropomorphic creatures. And very much like Sing, Rock Dog could have been incorporated into the Zootopia universe. And as much as I don't like one company monopolizing others, I really do think that if Disney had bought the rights to Sing and Rock Dog, they would have made two at least marginally compelling Zootopia spinoff films. And, of course, Zootopia, given how much money it made and the fact that it won an Academy Award, is inevitably going to have a sequel, but it almost feels like Rock Dog in particular, if it had been incorporated into the Zootopia universe, it might have been a better movie, which kind of already gives you an impression of what I actually think about this movie. So what is Rock Dog about? It is about a wide-eyed Tibetan mastiff who, when a radio falls from the sky into his hands, he leaves home to fulfill his dreams of becoming a musician, setting into motion a series of completely unexpected events. So, I'm not sure what breed this dog is. I'm not sure if Mastiff is a breed of dog, but it is problematic when the movie is called Rock Dog, and it's based on actually a story that's called Tibetan Rock Dog. Somebody named Ash Brannon wrote, I think, either a book entitled Tibetan Rock Dog or a story. But they just took the Tibetan part out of that. And while there are themes of kung fu in this movie, it's not entirely the center of the movie, even though there is some Asian influence on the... at least the small town part of this movie. But overall, I think it's riddled with a lot of movie cliches, not only from other animated films, but from other movies in general. There's a saying that there are only 7 plots to movies, or basically, yeah, there are 7 main plots from which a majority of movies borrow. And this movie seems to borrow a lot. There's the story of a young person whose father wants him to do one thing, but he wants to do something else. There's a story of him leaving home to pursue his dreams in the big city, where he finds out that pursuing his dreams is a lot harder than he anticipated. And there's also there's a part where bad guys try to take down the good guys, and the young son returns home in order to defend his land. These plots have been done so many times before. Oh, and there's one other thing. There's the tired plot of the aspiring musician or artist who creates this masterwork with his idol, and then the idol stabs him in the back and steals the idea from him, only to change his mind later. That's there too. So it's this amalgamation of such plot points. And for a movie that has marginally good animation, but overall, and while I credit the movie for staying away from pop culture references, of which this movie had none, I just still felt like the movie didn't interest me. It didn't make me laugh particularly as much. And there are a number of talented people who are voice actors in this movie. There's Luke Wilson, who plays the young Bodhi, the main character in this movie, the protagonist. Eddie Izzard plays his rock idol, Angus, who almost seems like an amalgamation of several rock stars like David Bowie. I'm trying to think of other people, too. And Eddie Izzard seemed to be doing a Russell Brand imitation here, which, or at least when I heard Eddie Izzard do the voice of this Angus character, this rock god, I thought he was Russell Brand. There's also J.K. Simmons as the disapproving father who later changes his mind. And there's Sam Elliott as a character named Fleetwood Yak. And there's that pun there, but you never see Fleetwood Yak, who's an anthropomorphic cow, play an instrument of any kind. He almost serves as the narrator of the movie. And while it's great to see, not to mention hear, Sam Elliott in a movie, he just doesn't really add very much, and his breaking the fourth wall isn't particularly clever, and I thought it was entirely unnecessary. That's not Sam Elliott's fault as much as it is the person who wrote the screenplay to this film. And another troubling thing is, I mentioned last break when I was reviewing The Great Wall that The Great Wall had a lot of backlash of whitewashing. All of which, the criticisms of The Great Wall being whitewashed were valid, but Rock Dog is even more guilty of whitewashing. Granted, Kenan Thompson, an African-American actor, is one of the voices, but for a movie that was originally intended to be called Tibetan Rock Dog, there are no Asian or Asian-American voice actors in this movie. At least Kubo and the Two Strings had some Asian-American and sometimes Asian voice actors. It didn't have enough. That was my only criticism of Kubo and the Two Strings. But this movie has none, and that is troubling. This movie, as I said, is probably more guilty of whitewashing than The Great Wall, because at least The Great Wall had mostly Asian and Asian American actors in it. It was, after all, about the Great Wall of China. But here, it just seemed like they stripped out the Tibetan from the title, and the Asian influences are in there, but I think it could have been actually a more clever movie had they stuck to the idea of a Tibetan theme, and maybe even tied in the idea of maybe freeing Tibet. I don't know. It's a stretch for an animated movie, but it's not entirely unwelcome. So unfortunately, even though Rock Dog is not nearly as bad a movie as Norm of the North from last year, it gets my rating of a strikeout. The animation is adequate. The voice actors do what they can with the characters they're given, but unfortunately, they're not given a lot, and the movie definitely... Welcome back to Words on Film on Boston Free Radio. I'm your host and movie critic, Dan Burke. Words on Film is the spoken word show dedicated to moving pictures, which I'll remind you again, you are either listening to on bostonfreeradio.com, watching on Somerville Community Access TV or some community access station somewhere in this country, or watching me on Facebook Live, either on my own page or on Boston Free Radio's page. Either way, I'm glad you could join me. The next movie I'm going to be reviewing for you is The Red Turtle, also known as La Tortue Rogue, which is one of the five animated movies that has been nominated for Best Animated Feature at this past year's Oscars. And even though it didn't get a wide release in America, which is really unfortunate, it is a very well-animated film that tells a very original story with no dialogue. Granted, some of the characters in the movie, the human characters, scream, but they don't actually enunciate any words. But this dialogue-less film follows the major life stages of a castaway on a deserted tropical island populated by turtles, crabs, and birds. This is a movie that does so well showing and not telling, because let's face it, when you're trapped on a deserted island by yourself, you usually don't do a lot of talking. So this is a combined collaborative effort between a Dutch director, Michael Dudok de Witt, and also the Japanese Studio Ghibli, who collaborated with a company from the Netherlands to distribute this film. And it's a movie you get into very quickly. You find out a little bit about how this man who's a castaway got onto this deserted tropical island. And there are other things that are explained through very clever and dialogue-less exposition. But what's really great about this movie is not just the story, but the very fluid hand-drawn animation that's also assisted very well by computer animation. In fact, once the titular character, the red turtle, makes his appearance, it's amazing how fluid he's animated and how effortlessly, seemingly effortlessly, the turtle moves. This is a movie that probably took at least a year to make, and the animation is superb. Of course, being in an American awards show, it probably did not have a chance against Zootopia or any of the other American animated films that were nominated this year, but it is definitely worth a look. So you see the struggles of this castaway as he learns to survive on this desert island. In fact, it brings to mind a lot of the scenes in the Robert Zemeckis directing Tom Hanks starring vehicle Castaway, in terms of what one experiences on a deserted island and how one tries to get off the deserted island. In fact, the castaway in this movie seems to have an easier time creating a rescue ship to get off the island and sail back to wherever it is he came. But unfortunately, for unforeseen circumstances, his boat keeps getting damaged every time he goes out to sea. So he swims back reluctantly to the island only to create another rescue ship and to get cast away once again. This happens again and again. And there are moments of the movie which are surprisingly funny. I think the funniest moments are the ones that you don't see coming. And I think that's probably for a good reason. Once the red turtle makes herself visible, that's where the movie gets a little confusing, but it also develops into not only an animated movie, but a fantasy one at that, and morphs into almost a retelling of Adam and Eve, if you will. And granted, there was another movie called The Blue Lagoon, which was billed as a retelling of Adam and Eve. This one is much better. This one has a better plot. If there were actors in the movie rather than voice actors, this movie would have been acted better. Yeah, The Red Turtle is the movie that The Blue Lagoon probably could have been and maybe should have been as well. So there's a lot to love about The Red Turtle. If you see this movie in theaters or in your local art house theater, definitely seek it out. And I've got about 2 minutes left before I get into the next part, but I've already explained to you the story, how great the animation is, how great the story is without any dialogue whatsoever. And this movie, I might as well just tell you, it gets my rating of a knockout. I guess that's just really all I have to say about it. And I apologize for not explaining any more about it, but I do have to say there are some plot developments that happen. There's one particular scene that's actually, I think for me being a little bit claustrophobic, is kind of hard to watch. It's a scene where the castaway is looking over a cliff, and then he slips on the cliff and falls into a ravine where there's seemingly no way out. But then he discovers he has to dive into the water and swim through these very tight rocks in order to get up out the other side and be safe again. I don't know if I would have been that brave. That scene is probably the hardest to watch, or at least it was for me. I was watching it in a relatively full movie theater, and when you see this guy squeezing through these rocks, I actually went, oh, and apparently somebody noticed that I had made that noise, and they kind of chuckled. But The animation in this movie during the scene shows the water not dark and murky like it would be realistically. And I don't know if anybody would have actually survived taking that dip into the water and coming out the other side, but it's still a fascinating scene to watch. So that really is all there is to say about The Red Turtle. It's a movie with a relatively simple plot, but the way the story evolves and the way the animation complements the story is quite fascinating. So I do think that The Red Turtle is going to be another movie like Spirited Away that Western audiences are going to slowly discover, but they'll be glad they discovered. On Boston Free Radio, I'm your host and movie critic, Dan Burke. Words on Film is the spoken word show dedicated to moving pictures, to which you are either listening on bostonfreeradio.com or watching on Somerville Community Access TV, that's SCAT-V, or Facebook Live. Either way, I'm glad you could join me to discuss my favorite topic, which is movies. So this is the part of the show where I give you a preview of what's coming out next in a segment I like to call What's Coming Up Next. And there is only one really big movie that's opening this coming weekend, the weekend of March 10th, and that is Kong Skull Island. This is the first movie about King Kong that's been released in 12 years, although it's good that the movies have actually been pretty spaced out. The last movie about Kong was the remake of King Kong, directed by Peter Jackson and starring Naomi Watts, Jack Black, and Adrian Brody. That movie was, I think, despite its massive budget, grossly underrated. I love the original King Kong, but the remake was certainly maybe not better than the original King Kong, but I think it used CGI and the usual storytelling techniques to make it almost on par with the original 1933 release, which was actually, trivia question, trivia fact, it was one of Adolf Hitler's favorite movies. Yeah, look it up. That's not the reason I like it, but far from it. But it shows you the influence that that movie had. That is, the wide-reaching love the movie had, even amongst people who hated Americans. I digress. But anyway, Kong Skull Island, I don't know if it's actually more of a remake of King Kong, but it focuses exclusively on Skull Island. And it's about a team of explorers and soldiers traveling to this uncharted island in the Pacific, unaware that they are crossing into the domain of monsters, including the mythic Kong. The director of this movie is not Peter Jackson, although he could have come back to direct this, but rather Jordan Vaught Roberts. And Jordan Vaught Roberts is a relatively young director who has brought us such movies before this as The Kings of Summer from 2013, which I haven't seen, but I hear good things about it. And another indie film called Successful it's a short film called Successful Alcoholics. Up to this point, other than The Kings of Summer, Jordan Vaught Roberts has directed a number of TV specials and a number of TV episodes. So this is his first huge movie. And the movie stars Tom Hiddleston, Samuel L. Jackson, Brie Larson, John C. Reilly, and others. And I don't think you could qualify this as a King Kong remake because it's a team of explorers and soldiers, not a team of movie makers who travel to Skull Island. And I'm also not sure if this takes place after the events of King Kong, either in the 1933 or the 2005 movie, or if it takes place after. It could take place after, I just don't know. But this is brought to you from the producers of the Godzilla movie, the original, or rather, not the original one, the most recent one starring Aaron Taylor Johnson, Caitlin Olson, Marcia Gay Harden, and Bryan Cranston. So if these original producers did such a good job with that Godzilla movie, which wasn't everyone's cup of tea, but I liked it, They have a good chance of doing well with Kong Skull Island. Of course, I will review it for you, and I'll let you know what I think next week. The other films that are coming out are ones that are in limited release. One of them is called Raw. This is a movie about a young vegetarian who undergoes a carnivorous hazing ritual at vet school and then develops an unbidden taste for meat that begins to grow in her. So this movie looks to be not American, but probably French. Its original title was Grave, and it's directed by Julia Ducournau, who is French. And it seems like everyone else in this movie is French as well. Let me just say, the poster to this movie looks intense, subtle, but intense. And I don't know if this movie is going to open up in a theater near me, but if it does, I might check it out. And I'll let you know what I think next week. But you can be rest assured that one of the movies that I'm going to review for you will be Kong Skull Island, because I hate to have that one pass me by. And yeah, I know this segment's called What's Coming Out Next, but I'm almost out of time. But I've got a lot of other movies to review for this show that I haven't reviewed yet. In fact, I'm going to mix that in for next week. And I hope you join me next week. I'm on Tuesdays at 1 p.m. to 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And this is just a reminder of the show Words on Film, the spoken word show dedicated to moving pictures. And I am your host and movie critic, Dan Burke. I'll be back next week to host, or rather to review more movies. And until then, I'll see you at the movies.